8, from verse 31 to the end of the chapter. We begin at the count of 3. Romans 8:31. 1, 2, 3. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Praise the Lord. Let us humbly seek the Lord in prayer. A gracious and adorable Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we come into your presence in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, knowing that we can come with boldness, not in ourselves, but with boldness in Christ. We thank you that Jesus Christ is our righteousness, because he died for our sins and he lived a perfect life for us, and both of those are put to our account and put within our minds and hearts to make us dead to self and alive with the righteousness, the love of God in Jesus Christ, all being brought to us by his Holy Spirit. We thank you for such good news. All around us in the world, the news is terrible. People are being slaughtered out in the east, in Nigeria, in Syria, in Iraq. The ISIS group continues their march. There is no security. There is no peace. But we thank you that there is peace in Christ. There is security in Christ. There is salvation in Christ. There is righteousness in Christ. And we thank you for the gospel, the fruit of the gospel, and the hope of the gospel. But we thank you that our gospel is Christ crucified, Christ risen, Christ interceding, Christ coming again. It is all Christ, his righteousness, and his death for us lost sinners. Have mercy upon us. Send your spirit and your angels to be in our midst. And as we continue with the second half of Lecture 17, A.T. Jones, 1893. Open the eyes of our understanding to receive, to experience, and to rejoice, so that with the Apostle Paul, we can ask the question, if God be for us, tell me who can be against us. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
Some where the clouds are rifted. so why should I worry our friend? I know he holds the future, and I know he holds my hand. I know just as sure as I'm singing this song, I'm a part in his almighty plan.
Singing this song, and I know that he holds the future in his hands. So why should I worry, oh friend?
Protect me and go with me each day, and brother, I've no reason to doubt. He's been so near me every step of the way, and he will surely lead his children on out. There are some people who live each day in fear of what tomorrow may bring. But I'm trusting in one who is walking so near. I'm talking about the King of all kings. I know he holds the future, and I know he holds my hand. I know just as sure as I'm singing this song, I'm a part in his almighty plan. I need Jesus,
and his blood just as sure as I'm singing this song, and I know that he holds the future in his hands. So why should I worry, oh friend?
Praise the Lord. And that special music ties in beautifully as we continue now. Hope you have a handout. Righteousness by Faith and the Promise of the Spirit, part 2. Last half of the message that we started last week. Remember where we ended? We continue now. Well then, the Lord has bought us, has he not? Now, as far as you and I are concerned, we need not have any more doubt as to whether we are the Lord's. That is so? Congregation answers, yes. Is that clear? Before we were born, God bought us through the blood of his son. That is a fact. He paid the money. If somebody has paid money for land and house for you, the land and house are yours. If you refuse to own it, that is your business. But the land and house have been bought for you. And so, thank you, Brother Stephen. Thanks. Thank you. So notice how the reformer starts. Well then, the Lord has bought us. Has he not? Now as far as you and I are concerned, we need have not any more doubt as to whether we are the Lord's. That is so, congregation, yes. Follow again carefully. But there are some people in the world who are not really in real experience, and as a matter of fact, so far as the consummation of the bargain is concerned, they have not submitted themselves to the Lord and are not practically his. You follow the two dimensions the reformer is preaching at? We are the Lord's, he paid the price. But we only become his in our actual experience now. Now remember, you're his. But that becomes an experience when we give ourselves to him because he already paid the price for us. Is this too loud? Sounds a bit loud to me. Gentlemen in the technical area, lower it, because my voice is not weak, so lower it a bit. The pressure will be too much for certain ears. Too much for mine. Thank you. Okay. Next sentence says, he has made them his by purchase. Now, how can they know that they are his practically and indeed? By his word. By choosing for themselves to have it just that way by choice. Praise the Lord. When God called Abraham, I told Abraham, I'm going to make your seed like these stars. That was God's part. Abraham's part is, do you say that, Lord? I believe it. And the matter was finished. When we agree with what the Lord has done and believe what the Lord has done and give the Lord what he paid the price for, ourselves and our sin, then we become practically his experientially. But we are his already. But we can become practically his experientially when we surrender to him. The reformer continues, page 44 in Steps to Christ, gives the whole philosophy of it. It tells how to make the surrender of ourselves to God. It says that your promises and resolutions are like ropes of sand, and the knowledge of your broken promise and forfeited pledges weakens your confidence in your own sincerity. And finally, what you need to understand is the true force of the will. You cannot save yourself. You cannot change your heart. But you can choose to serve him. When the man chooses to put his will on the side where God's will is, then the thing is accomplished. Praise the Lord. Then it is at a man's choice that he practically, in his own experience, becomes the Lord's indeed. Then is it not by the man's own permission, in choosing the Lord's way, that the man becomes the Lord's in practical experience? And the answer to that question, of course, is yes. Then, having done that, don't you see that so long as your choice is there, so long as your wish is there to be the Lord's, don't you see that you are the Lord's indeed? Do you see that? Whenever we deliver ourselves up to him, that is so. But some of you delivered yourself up long ago, but then, since that, you have been discouraged and wondering whether you were the Lord's or not. We want people tonight, we want people today, to get that doubt and question forever out of the way, so that whatever comes up, you will not be bothering about whether you are the Lord's. That's the sound we just heard? That's the sound we just heard? Let's go over that sentence again. We want people tonight to get that doubt and question forever out of the way, so that whatever comes up, you will not be bothering about whether you are the Lord's. Just as certainly as your choice is there to be his, you are his, for he bought you long ago. Praise the Lord. That is the thing I'm after. Is that what you are after? You are to take it if you ever get it. Congregation, amen. Then we can know that we are the Lord's. But now sometimes we hear people talk as though that was going to sanction sin. You understand what the reformer is in? The truth that Jesus died for our sins and paid the redemption price for us, and we are his legally, and then when we give ourselves to him, we become his experientially. The truth that Jesus paid the redemption price for us, some people say that will sanction sin and lower standards. Listen to Jones. No, it will not do that. No, it will save you from sinning. When a man gets into that place and his choice is there to be the Lord's, then God works in him both to will and to do of his own good pleasure. And he's a Christian. God will make him a Christian. Let me explain something briefly here for a moment. In the years before the 1888 message came, the 1888 message came in 1888. From the time the church went into lukewarmness officially, 1859, right up to 1888, what was God doing through Ellen White? Sending warning after warning after warning, talking about all the standards that were dropping and everything else. What did it do for the church? What did people take those warnings and do? Some ignore them. Others took the warnings and spun them into legalism, depending on themselves to reach the standard. So the whole church rejected the message. Some by legalism, some by complete neglect. So the warnings did what for the church? Nothing. What did God therefore have to turn around to? Stop sending warnings now and say what? The everlasting gospel? Send the everlasting gospel. Because when people believe what God has done for them, it brings them to a certain critical point of decision. That's what the Lord Christ will do. So you send a man warning after warning, standard after standard, and he isn't sure that his salvation is secure in Christ, he will either turn that warning to legalism and say, better than you because I do what you do, or he will panic and give up altogether. So the gospel was what Laodicea needed. Because all the warnings God sent did nothing for Laodicea, then God sent the gospel. Now that's not to despise the warnings, for had they applied those warnings through the gospel, they would have had them. But they had lost the gospel. So warnings without gospel either create panic or create legalism. So God sent the gospel. And so people were shocked and came to Sister White and says, is this what Jones and Wagner preaching, the third angel's message? We thought the third angel's message was law and prophecy and do this and don't do that. Ellen White says, I tell you, it is the third angel's message in verity. So here's Jones now presenting the heart of the gospel. God has bought you. That is a fact. And when you believe it and give to him what he has bought, that will bring his righteousness into experience, and every standard that is required will be met by Christ in you and Christ in me. Okay. That's a little digression. So let's continue with that paragraph. That is the divine power there. Sorry. Let me go over that part there again. But now we sometimes hear people talk as though that was going to sanction sin. No, it will not do that. No, it will save you from sinning. When a man gets into that place and his choice is there to be the Lord's, then God works in him both to will and to do of his own good pleasure. And he's a Christian. God will make him a Christian. That is the divine power there in the thing. There is no sanction of sin about it. In fact, it is the only way to keep from sinning. I hope those of us who have been following this message for a long time will understand that this was the problem that Smith and Butler had. Smith and Butler thought, T-H-O-G-H-D, that what Jones and Wagner taught, T-A-W-G-H-D, would lessen, T-A-U-G-H-D, would lessen the impact of the law. What was Jones and Wagner saying? That the law in Galatians was the moral law. What did Smith and Butler teach? That the law in Galatians was the ceremonial law. And they felt that if they accepted the 1888 message, all the standards they had set with law would come tumbling down, and we would have no answer to the first day keepers who attacked the law. And what did Jones and Wagner? So Butler had a book called The Law in Galatians. Wagner wrote a book called The Gospel in Galatians. The good news. So sometimes when the good news is preached, people panic over standards. But really and truly, the only true attainment of any standard comes through the gospel. A man can externally reach a standard through willpower. Listen to me carefully. A man can externally reach a standard through willpower. And looks good to you, who can read what? The external behavior, but you can't read the heart. Are you with me? And when we come to the last two messages, when we come to the covenants, you will see that again. All right. Any other profession does sanction sin. Any other profession does do just what the Lord complains of, that men have made him to serve with their sins. What does the Lord say? You have made me to serve with your sin. Isaiah 43:24. Let us stop it. Let our will and our choice be the Lord's every moment of our conscious days, and then it is a fact. Victory is a fact. Praise the Lord. Let us turn and read that verse that says so. 1 Corinthians 6:19, and the last words of the verse, you are not your own. That is so, is it not? You're not your own. I don't care who the man is. Is he his own? Congregation, no, sir. And why are you not your own? Because somebody has bought you. The Lord has bought him. And if he does not let the Lord have him, listen carefully now, if he does not let the Lord have him, he is robbing the Lord of that which is the Lord's own. Because the Lord has bought us, and if we don't give ourselves to the Lord, that's the first thing wrong. We are stealing, because we are robbing God of what he bought. He bought you, and he bought me. And if I don't give him my heart, I am robbing the Lord. That is the mischief of it. That is the mischief of it. Though he be not consciously and practically the Lord's, yet the Lord has bought everyone, and any man who refuses to let the Lord have him, he is robbing the Lord of that which he bought and for which he paid the price, and he's counting the price which bought him as worth less than himself. Now, these are very serious thoughts. We went through these when we came to the unpardonable sin. Anytime we reject the gospel, we are counting the price that Jesus paid for our souls to be less than us. Now that's such a serious thing. The Pharisees thought they had enough righteousness to buy themselves, that they could satisfy the price. So how did the Pharisee pray? Lord, I thank you that I'm not like that man. That's how the Pharisee begins his prayer. But the publican starts by saying, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. Jesus says, which of these two men went down to his house justified? I tell you, it was the publican. Because though the Pharisee thought that he was reaching every standard, he reached none. Because doing it in his willpower could not be acceptable by God. And of course, the moment I say that, the question comes up again. Brother Douglin, are you not going to be lowering standards? I tell you, it's the only way to keep standards, the gospel. Look at how the people in the religion of the East keep standards of morality, what they call morality. What do? They cut off and kill and lick up and blow up to maintain their standards. Is there any righteousness in them to save us all? Even their own people hate the very guts of that system. It is righteousness by fear and force to keep what they call their standard. They had a woman the other day. The woman was married to a Christian man, said what she was. They sentenced the woman to death. They have a standard to maintain. Which standard that is? So, the true gospel is the only way to maintain standards. Because when a man puts his will on the side of God, the righteousness of God will lift him to whatever standard God requires. Anything else may look good to us, but it is Ishmael. Ishmael was a son, wasn't he? Ishmael was a human being born. Anybody pass and say, well, that's Ishmael's son. But it was not the son of promise. And God could not accept Ishmael. Now notice the old covenant produced something, you know. The old covenant, when Abraham went into Hagar, she didn't get wind, she got a son. But it was not the son of promise. So by willpower and everything else, we can produce many sons of many standards, but they're not acceptable to God. Only the son of promise. So Jones had to keep asking that question because he knew that Butler and Jones were there waiting on him. You lowering standards in this church. Jones says, but the standards been here all the time. God been sending warnings. Have you kept them? Because you have Ishmael and presenting Isaac. And when we put our will on the side of God's will, reverence, respect, morality, keeping every standard will be done in us when we put our will on the side of God, knowing that Christ is our righteousness. We are not here talking about lowering standards. We are here talking about the only way all standards can be maintained to God's acceptance. So Jones had to keep asking this question because Jones knew he and Wagner, they were under attack. Okay. Next paragraph. I'm sorry for the spacings here with the computer spacings, but we'll correct that by the time we come to get it in the book form. Though he be not consciously and practically the Lord's, let the Lord has bought everyone, and any man who refuses to let the Lord have him, he's robbing the Lord of that which he bought and for which he paid the price. And he's counting the price which bought him as worth less than himself. Is not that the same satanic spirit that sought to put itself above God in heaven? The Lord gave himself for us. Then when I will not let him have me in that very thing, I count myself worth more than the price that was paid. That is, worth more than the Lord. And that is the self-same self that puts itself above God all the time. Now, in other words, the religious carnal-mindedness is more cancerous than the out-and-out sinning carnal-mindedness in the rum shop. Because the religious carnal-mindedness has a self-righteousness that looks good. Lord, I thank you that I'm not like that man. I pay double tithe. See the religious self-righteousness? It will never accept that it is a sinner and that Christ had to buy it. My price can handle me. It's a serious thing. And Jones is equating self-righteousness to the satanic spirit. It is worse. That's why Jesus said, I wish you were cold or hot. It is worse than the man out there. Serious thing. So now he comes on now to a very important point. Oh, let this mind be in us that was in Christ Jesus. The King James Version of Philippians 2 uses the 1611 translators use the term, made himself of no reputation. And many people read that, they don't really know what that means. Made himself of no reputation. You know what the Greek says? He emptied himself. That's the correct translation. He emptied himself that God might be again, that God again might be united in one. Last paragraph, you're not your own. Are you? Congregation, no. Are you not glad of it? Are you not glad you are not your own? Are you not glad you are not your own?
He says so, and it is so. Is it not? Why is it? For you are bought with a price. He bought us, therefore we are not our own. And before all people in the world who are not their own is the man who has yielded himself to the Lord who has bought him. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are the Lord's. Whose are they? Congregation God's. But I need not dwell longer on these verses, brethren. You do that, will you? You dwell on them. Well, now, we have read the verses. He gave himself for us. He bought us. How much of us? Congregation, all of us. When was it that he did it? Congregation, before the foundation of the world. What kind of folks were we before the foundation of the world? What kind of folk were we when God bought us? We were just ourselves, just as we were in this world. And he bought us sinners just as we are. Congregation, yes. Now, did he? Honestly, no. We are coming to another thought here. Now, did he pay that price and buy us just as we were sinners? Congregation, yes. So when Jesus bought us, we were not righteous. He bought us as we were sinners. Bad, lost, undone. A waste of time, that's when he bought us. So when we commit sin and come to God and confess and repent, acknowledging that he's already pardoned us at the cross, when we confess and repent, we receive the forgiveness called Aphimi in 1 John 1:9, the matter is done. Time cannot atone. What people say cannot atone. The blood of Christ atones. So we continue. Evil beings are willing to go in evil ways, willing to do evil things, making no profession of religion, and not particularly wanting to. Did he buy us then? Congregation, yes, that's when he bought us. When we were completely out and out bad. What did he buy us just, what did he buy us just then? He bought us and all there was of us. And as he bought what there was of us, he bought our sins. Isaiah describes it, wounds and bruises and putrefying sores, no soundness at all. Is that so? Yes. Here's another text, Titus 3:3-7. For we ourselves also were sometimes foolish, disobedient, serving diverse lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. Now, can anybody say that this doesn't apply to them? Yeah, of course people can say so. Will they be telling the truth? No. But after that, the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. He did it. He says so. Then, do you know that that is so? Congregation, yes. Well, now let us carry it a little further. He gave himself for our sins. But the same thought goes through all. He will not take our sins, although he bought them, without our permission. Follow the reformer now. Look at it a little further, carrying the same thought forward. He gave himself for whose sins? Ours. Whose were they? Congregation, ours. He gave himself for them. They being ours, to whom did he give himself when he bought them? Congregation, to us. He gave himself to me for my sins. Congregation, yes. Then the choice is forever with me as to whether I would rather have my sins than to have him, isn't it? Congregation, yes. That is the living choice before me. Is it? Congregation, yes. Is that the choice before you? Congregation, yes. Which would you rather have, your sins or Christ? Congregation, Christ. Then from this time henceforth, can there be any hesitation about letting anything go that God shows is sin? Can there be any hesitation? No. Will you let it go when it is pointed out? When sin is pointed out to you, say, I would rather have Christ than that. I'll let it go, congregation. Amen. Just tell the Lord, Lord, I make the choice now. I make the trade. I make thee my choice. It is gone. I have something better. Thank the Lord. Now comes the question. Then where in the world is the opportunity for any of us to get discouraged over our sins? Hear that question? Now, of course, Satan will want to make us discouraged over our sins. Other church members will want to make us discouraged over our sins because they don't have any. But this comes to the point now. Then where in the world is the opportunity for any of us to get discouraged over our sins? Jesus died for them. Jesus bought them. And when we let him have them, they're gone. Now, some of the brethren here have done that very thing. Follow carefully. This is the latter rain message now. They came here free. They thought they were free. But the Spirit of God brought up something they never saw before. The Spirit of God went deeper than it ever went before and revealed things they never saw before. And then instead of thanking the Lord that that was so and letting the whole wicked business go and thanking the Lord they had ever so much more of him than they ever had before, they began to get discouraged. And they said, oh, what am I going to do? My sins are so great. There they let Satan cast a cloud over them and throw them into discouragement. And they get no good out of the meetings day after day. You're following the line of reformers. Then you come to a meeting, you feel you're all right. The Holy Spirit then shows you deep-seated sins, anger, malice, envy, bitterness. All those things, the sins that we don't usually talk about, you know, we talk about the other sins. Anger, bitterness, pride, selfishness, self-centeredness, the Holy Spirit shows. And then you get this. But is the Holy Spirit showing you those sins to get you discouraged? No. To tell you, Jesus has bought those sins, just let them go. And I'm showing you that you can let them go. That's the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Next sentence. There they let Satan cast a cloud over them and throw them into discouragement, and they get no good out of the meetings day after day. Isn't that too bad? Isn't it too bad that a person whom the Lord has loved so much as to give himself for him at all should act that way with the Lord when the Lord wants to reveal more of himself? Brethren, if any of you have got into discouragement, let us quit. Let us quit getting discouraged. That's a serious thing. If the Lord has brought up sins to us, and let me just make this point. In the book Steps to Christ, Ellen White says there are two things that Satan uses to trap us. Listen to these two things. We don't think about them. The faults of others and our own faults. The faults of others and our own faults. And of course, we don't worry with the own fault thing. We see all the faults of others. Criticize this thing, criticize the next thing. And we closer to the Lord. And we feel we get closer to the Lord by criticizing that and criticizing that. Well, that's evidence that we're far from the Lord. Because the publican who was closest to the Lord says what? Lord, have mercy on Elliot Douglin, a sinner. Not on Joseph, a sinner. On Elliot Douglin, a sinner. The publican says, everybody's better than me, so Lord, have mercy on me. The Pharisee says, I'm better than everybody, so have mercy on them. See the two different prayers? So when the Holy Spirit brings up sins, whatever the sin is, and I know that Jesus died for that sin and exhausted the penalty, and I can't make atonement for it, and I let it go and have Christ rather than that, the matter is done. And if I put anything else in that equation, I feel that I am therefore adding to the atonement. That is the same mind that puts itself above the price that was paid, which is the Son of God. And that's a serious thing. So, we continue. Isn't that too bad? Isn't it too bad that a person whom the Lord has loved so much has to give himself for him at all should act that way with the Lord when the Lord wants to reveal more of himself? Brethren, if any of you have got into discouragement, let us quit. That's where we were. Now, if the Lord has brought up sins to us that we never thought of before, that only shows that he's going down to the depths and he will reach the bottom at last. And when he finds the last thing that is unclean or impure and that is out of harmony with his will and brings that up and shows that to us and we say, I would rather have the Lord than that, then the work is complete and the seal of the living God can be fixed upon that character. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But if I feel okay, if I come to church and when I hear a message, I feel okay, but I say, see, brother so-and-so, he ain't up to standard, but I'm okay. That is a sure sign that I am not letting the Holy Spirit do anything in me or for me. And in my self-righteousness, I criticize and condemn. But I am the one in mortal danger. Which would you rather have? A character? And before Jones could finish the sentence, someone in the congregation began praising the Lord. And others began to look around at this person who was praising the Lord. And Jones said, never mind. If lots more of you would thank the Lord for what you have got, there will be more joy in this house tonight. Which would you rather have? The completeness, the perfect fullness of Jesus Christ, or have less than that with some of your sins covered up that you never knew of, congregation? His fullness. But don't you see, and the testimonies have told us, that if there be stains of sin there, we cannot have the seal of God. How in the world can that seal of God, which is the impress of his perfect character revealing us, be put upon us when there are sins about us? He cannot put the seal, the impress of his perfect character, upon us until he sees it there. And so he's got to dig down to the deep places we never dreamed of because we cannot understand our hearts. But the Lord knows the heart. He tries the conscience. He will cleanse the heart and bring up the last vestige of wickedness. Let him go on, brethren. Let him keep on his searching work. And when he does bring our sins before us, let the heart say, Lord, thou give us thyself for my sins. Oh, I take thee instead of them. They are gone, and I rejoice in the Lord. Brethren, let us be honest with the Lord and treat him as he wants us to. Then he gave himself to us for our sins. And notice that. He not only gave himself for our sins, but he gave himself to us for our sins. That's the exchange. He takes away our sins and gives us himself. Then I say again, and you see that it is simply with you and with me a living choice as to whether we will have the Lord or ourselves, the Lord's righteousness or our sins, the Lord's say or our say. Which shall we have, congregation, the Lord's way? There is no difference in making the choice when we know what the Lord has done and what he is to us. The choice is easy. Let the surrender be complete. And when these sins come up, why? They were surrendered long ago. Then, that is all they are brought up for, that we can make the choice. This is the blessed work of sanctification. And we can know that that work of sanctification is going on in us. If the Lord should take away our sins without our knowing it, what would that do for us? That would simply be making machines of us. He does not propose to do that. Consequently, he wants you and me to know that when our sins, he wants you and me to know when our sins go, that we may know that his righteousness comes. It is when we yield ourselves that we have him. It is true that the scriptures say we are instruments of God. And don't you forget that we are always intelligent instruments, not like the instrument, a pick or a shovel that man would use. They're utterly senseless. That is not it. But we are intelligent instruments. We will be used by the Lord at our own living choice, our own living choice upon his side, choosing that he will do that with us, and that it is, and then it is done, because his almighty power carries on the work. Then he gave himself for our sins. And now he comes and says, there is sin. What then? Lord, it is sin. That is confession. When the Lord says it is sin, and we say, Lord, yes, it is sin, that is confession. The root idea of confession is to speak the same thing. The root idea of the Greek word translated confession is to speak the same thing. That is confession. The Lord said to David, you have sinned and done this evil. David said, I have sinned. That is confession. The Bible says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. That is the aphemi forgiveness that takes sin from us. What does God show them for anyway? The only thing that he shows men their sins for is that he may take them away. You see, Jones understands the full meaning of the 1 John 1:9 confession. Aphemi, take the sin away. When he shows me sins, and I say, Lord, there are sins, what then? They're forgiven. They're gone. Now you folks have confessed your sins since you have been here, haven't you? All that the Lord has shown you, have you? There's a question for me and you to answer. Have we let the Lord take all that he shows us is sin? The Lord has said so. What do you say, congregation? Amen. But Satan says it is not so. Now, Satan is a liar. But some folks here have been saying that Satan tells the truth upon that point. Follow carefully now. People in this house have been telling Satan that he told the truth upon that very point. Satan says, your sins are not forgiven. And they say, no, they're not. So they're saying that Satan is telling the truth and God is a liar. Well. Are you following? You sure you're following? Let us quit that. We confess our sins that they may be forgiven. And the Lord says they're forgiven. And when they're forgiven, why then in the Lord's name, let us say so. So when we understand what God has done for us, and we confess and repent, and the Lord takes away our sins, the forgiveness of 1 John 1:9, he has forgiven us. It is done. Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of that faith which he had. The Lord says, come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. What do you say, congregation? It is so. How do you know, congregation? The Lord says so. Very good. Then you know that it is so. Do you? Micah 7:19. He will turn again. He will have compassion upon us. He will subdue our iniquities. And thou wilt cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. Then, where are they, congregation? In the depths of the sea. How do you know, congregation? God says so. Then you know that, don't you? Then how in the world is anybody going to bother you about getting your sins back to you when God has taken them away and put them in the depths of the sea? Psalm 103:12, as far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. How far are they removed from you now? You have confessed them. How far are they away? Over the page. Voice, as far as the east is from the west. Why don't you say so then? Satan comes and says, they're not forgiven. Every sin is right there before your face. Don't you see them? That's what Satan says. Are they? Congregation, no. Says one, I have seen them there. It is nothing of the kind. Satan is a magician and can make things appear so that they're not so. But you look at them and say, yes, that is so. It is not so. The Lord says they are as far from you as the east is from the west. They are in the depths of the sea, and they are as white as snow. Now thank the Lord. Isaiah 38:17, and that verse is the last one we need tonight. Behold, for peace I had great bitterness, but thou hast in love to my soul delivered it from the pit of corruption. For thou hast cast all my sins behind thy back. How many? Congregation, all. Behind his back. Where are they then? Congregation, behind his back. We are before his face, and the sins are behind his back. Who is between us and them? Congregation, God. Hallelujah. And he is upon his throne, isn't he? Then when I have confessed my sins to the Lord, he and his living eternal throne stand between me and those sins. And Satan and everybody else in this universe cannot bring them back. For he's got to get the Lord and his throne out of the way before he can get those sins back to me again. And I am going to be glad of it. Can we know these things? Now this shows us what the faith is that brings the latter in. It's not a doubting faith. It's a faith that believes that Jesus died for our sins. God forgives us. Those sins are removed. God cast them in the depths of the sea. They are behind his back. We agree with God. And we now live as if that is true. So remember what Sister White says in Steps to Grace. Two tricks of Satan that put the church in trouble, put us in trouble. The faults of others and our own faults. And for most of us, it's the faults of others because we ain't got no faults. And when you start dwelling on the faults of others, you can feel real good about yourself, but you're going deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. A man has cancer, and every day you see him, you just tell him, you got cancer, you got cancer, you got cancer. But the man will either get vest and give you cancer, or when he to see. The man wants a cure. And every day you see the man, you got cancer, you got cancer, you got cancer. That's it then. You're a sinner. All your sins there. You think God can forgive them? And we say, I ain't sure the Lord has forgiven me. We're calling Satan the truth teller and Jesus a liar. The serious thing. And all of us know that Satan has discouraged us on this point. The Apostle Paul said when he looked back, I realized that he was a killer. Paul was a murderer, no? Murdered Christians. But how did Paul count himself? The chief sinner. And surrendered all at the foot of the cross, and he had peace. So don't let Satan discourage us. Can we know these things? We're coming to the end. Can we know that we know them? He's asking two questions. Can we know these things? And can we know that we know them? How can we know that we know them? The Lord says so. When he says so, and we believe it, that is faith. You see what faith is? God says so. And we believe it. That is faith. Satan says they are not forgiven. We say, I know they are. Satan says, no. There they are. We say, they are not there. They are in the depths of the sea. And a voice in the congregation shouted out, praise the Lord. When the man stands there, there is something that God can put his seal on. So easy it is. When the Lord says, thy sins are forgiven, that he cast them behind his back, and the man will not believe it, is there anything there that God can put his seal on? No. Because this man is calling God a liar now. Someone asked that Isaiah 43:25 be read, which Elder Jones did. And he read it, I am he that blotteth out thy transgressions for my own sake. I will remember them no more, will not remember thy sins. There are many other texts like that, which we might notice. One is found in Hebrews 8:15. Their sins will I remember no more. And another in Ezekiel 33:16. None of his sins that he hath committed shall be mentioned unto him. You heard that? A sin is committed, We believe what Christ has done for us. The pardon we have at the cross before we were born. That pardon moves us now to repentance and confession. And we let God do the forgiveness of 1 John 1:9, which is a feme, take the sin from us. And he says he will not mention it. Here the Lord says he will remember, or he will not remember our sins. The Lord will never mention them. It is Satan's work to mention them. Brethren, let us believe the Lord. When we believe that, then God will give you and me the circumcision of the heart, the seal of the righteousness of the faith that we have. And he can do it because there's something there he can put a seal upon. And when a man does that as an individual, he receives the seal of righteousness. And when we as a whole body, as a church, believe that, we can ask with perfect confidence for the outpouring of his Holy Spirit and wait patiently and confidently, knowing that it will surely come in his own good time. Praise the Lord. But if we are doubting and believing Satan, when we confess, still don't feel the Lord has forgiven us and all of that, that is the unbelief that keeps us in lukewarmness. Well, take a time and go through it your own. We have two more messages to go in this series on how the Sabbath ties in with the gospel. And those two messages will be broken by next week, the message for Health Focus on healthy minds and healthy bodies, and then the communion message, and then we come back to finish off these just before camp. I think it is fitting that we sing that song now, "What Can Wash Our Sins Away? Nothing But the Blood of Jesus." May the Lord help us to believe the Lord. And when he says he has taken our sins away, to let them go and believe that he has. Brother Bruce.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fault I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon, this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fault I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Now by this I'll overcome, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Now by this I'll reach my home, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Glory, glory, this I say, nothing but the blood of Jesus. All my praise for this I bring, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
One sister has come forward, Sister Kenesha, come. And I'm going to pray for her. She's a young, precious soul, and let us kneel in prayer, because sometimes we undergo trials and difficulties and problems, and she has the assurance today, as she heard the message, that God loves her. Her sins are forgiven. They're cast behind his back. They're cast to the depths of the sea. And all the troubles that Satan may want to bring, all the doubts, you can be assured, dear sister, that Jesus' love for you is unconditional. He will give you peace and joy in your soul. You don't have to struggle. You have to simply accept. And his peace that passeth understanding will give you that inner happiness and joy that your soul, and all of us, need. And as I pray for her, and as we all kneel in prayer, let us pray that indeed God will give us the faith to believe his word, to let go of our sins and take Christ instead, knowing that those sins are cast behind his back, and he and his throne are between them and us. And doesn't matter what Satan says and other people say in finding fault or whatever they do, once we are surrendered to him, if each of us seeks that first love by getting back to Christ, the church problem is finished. Let us pray. Gracious Father, our sisters come forward, and all of us are kneeling before you in as much need as she is in need. Have mercy upon us all. I pray that you would comfort her and give her peace
and the assurance that our sins are forgiven, that you have paid the price for her soul, that she belongs to you, that you love her, and let no suggestion of the enemy disturb the assurance that the cross has made peace for even her and me and all of us. We thank you for the everlasting gospel. We thank you for all that Christ has done for us before we were born or before we could choose. And now we can choose, and we put our will on your side. Surrender to you. It becomes a practical experience that all you have already done is brought into us by your Holy Spirit as we surrender all. And the righteousness manifested in our life is the same righteousness of Christ that covers us. We can never make atonement for our past mistakes or our past sins, but your blood has done it. There's nothing we can do to atone or to make up. You have done it all, and we thank you. It is done. It is so. As we look towards now the health focus activities and then our camp meetings, prepare our hearts. Lord, you know that there are many difficulties. People can find many faults, and each of us has many. But thank the Lord, as your Holy Spirit brings up these faults, and each of us lets them go, the problems of the church will be solved. I am not to search out the faults of Brother X. I am to know my own faults and let them go and have Christ rather than them. Do this for each of us and make everything right as it has been in Jesus Christ. Again, pour your spirit on our dear sister, and as she's come forward, enable her to surrender all and give her the faith to believe your word that she's accepted, forgiven, blessed, and give them peace, and have mercy on us all. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen and amen. God bless you, and be at peace. God bless. May God bless you real good.